Praise the Lord, everybody. Oh, come on, that's a command. Praise the Lord, everybody. Isn't he worthy? Praise the Lord, everybody. Can we get the lights on in here? Come on, I didn't come to spectate. I came to participate. Praise the Lord, everybody. Father, we bless you. We give you glory in this place. You're worthy of all the praise. If it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? Anybody grateful? Where are the grateful people today? Come on, we came to show an expression. Can you offer God something this morning? Your praise, your worship, your gratefulness. Has he been good to anybody over here? Come on, can you release a sound into the atmosphere? Come on, can you release a sound into the atmosphere? Right now, we're not asking for anything, but we want to give him something. So can you give him the fruit of your lips? Father, I can't tell you what you did for them, but let me tell you, I know where you brought me from. So I give you glory. Thank you for keeping me from falling. Catching me when I almost gave up. Keeping me in my right mind. Giving me the activities of my limb. Oh, come on, I don't see enough gratefulness in this house. Woo! Oh, come on, we stirring up the gift. Stirring up the gift. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And we thank you for the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Are there any blood-washed believers in the house? Oh, come on. I don't know what the blood covered for you, but I know what it covered for me. So amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Maybe you weren't messed up, but that saved a wretch like me. Anybody in here, is this your testimony? I once was lost. I said I once was lost. Woo! I feel the power of Jesus in this house. Oh, God is going to wreck the place today. If you call him, he'll come. If you call him, he'll come. If you need him, you better call him. I don't know what you need. And we can sit and look real cute. But if you call him, he will come. Come on, come on, come on. I call on you, Jesus. I call on you, Jesus. I call you waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. I call you, Jesus. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Sikkenu, Jehovah Shalom. He's my banner. He's my righteousness. Jesus, 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 Jesus. That's the only name that has power. Jesus, 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 Jesus. I can call him and he's never too busy. Jesus, 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 Jesus. That power in that name. Oh, I came to stir up some stuff today. I said I came to stir up some stuff today. Some of y'all been stiff a long time. It ain't gonna hurt you, just wave your hands at him. If you need something to break in your life, do me a quick favor. I want you to think about everything that has you bound. Think about everything. We are troubled on every side. We got pressure everywhere. But I want you to declare and decree in the atmosphere that today I am breaking loose. Oh, y'all still ain't ready. I said, I want you to do this. Today, I'm breaking loose. Oh, I need to hear you. I said, today, I'm breaking. Oh, there's freedom in the house. Oh, there's deliverance in the house. Y'all ain't ready. I said, there's freedom in the house. There's breakthrough in the house. There's deliverance in the house. Oh, that's what he's doing. He's breaking some stuff today. He's loosing some stuff today. Woo! Y'all. Listen, listen, listen. Don't y'all push me. I'm telling y'all, after the wind that blew through here yesterday, I said after the tsunami that came through here yesterday, I said after the weight of glory that sat on us yesterday, woo, my God, listen, listen. I don't do all this hollering and carrying on. I don't know what's going on today. But when I think of the goodness of Jesus, it don't take a lot for me when I think of the goodness of Jesus. I ain't even got to think that far back. When I think about the goodness of Jesus, oh, I believe that today is going to be a day of miracle manifestation. I believe that today is going to be a day where destinies will be declared. I believe today is going to be a day where you come into alignment with your assignment. I believe today is going to be a day that you get positioned in your purpose. Can y'all feel him already? He's troubling the waters. And you know what happens when the water is troubled? You gotta get yourself, you gotta get close to the pool. Woo! Listen, listen, listen. Thank y'all. One more time, give God a hand clap of praise in this place. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I done got happy. They got up here and got happy. I'm so grateful for the opportunity to be here. My voice kind of in and out because I'd carried on so yesterday. Who was in the house yesterday? Throw your hands up. Good God Almighty. Yeah, by the end of the day, the rest of y'all gonna feel just like that too. But I came, and I'm so grateful. Can we just stop and honor the angels of this house? Pastor and lady, I'm so grateful. Thank y'all. Just the openness, the hospitality, the people that carry their spirit, just the liberty to come in my own way and just carry on a scandal, like my grandma used to say. And, you know, getting this out of the way again. Elder Christy, bless you. She found me and said, hey, I need you to come to our church. So I'm so grateful for your obedience. I'm grateful for the team that traveled with me. I'm grateful for my friends that came, shut their churches down, and carried on. And can y'all wave at me, my friends that's in the house? All y'all that can, thank y'all for coming. I appreciate all y'all that showed up. I'm just so grateful and so honored to be here. I'm grateful to God and for this assignment. And I gave the people yesterday a few disclaimers, so half of y'all weren't here. So let me just do a quick recap. Number one, I'm grown. It's good to get that out of the way. I'm in my good 40s. 3 grown children. So I'm well able to carry this word. Amen. Secondly, there is a very unorthodox anointing that I operate in. I walk in the office of the prophet, but there is the apostolic anointing that flows. And so you will experience that, because I believe in saying what I say and then shifting the house, because I'm on assignment. And I believe that the power of the Lord is going to hit this house like never before. The power of the Lord is going to hit this house like never before. Bring her to me. Can y'all point your hands? One of the things that the Lord is doing, even here, I told my team that God was troubling the water. And anybody that's tapped in is going to be able to sense some things stirring. I need everybody to open up your insides. Because he's troubling the waters. He's troubling the waters. Some people don't even need a word. In Jesus' name. So today we know that this ministry has been in a place where you've been talking about recovery and talking about relapse. And I heard that I'm closing out this series from relapse to recovery. And I love the fact that God demonstrated it first. Woo! That's just the kind of God he is. And so as this even sets the stage for what God is doing, I want you to understand that in this season, this is what ministry is going to look like. When God has permission to interrupt our lives to do what he needs to, when we're not so caught up in what we're trying to do that we give room for what he wants to do. Can I say that again for the people in the back? When we stop getting so caught up in what we want to do, that we give him room to do what he needs to do. Tell your neighbor, that's what ministry looks like. Take your seats. All right. Let me get this word. I got to drop this revelation and then I'm going to flow. And there's going to be, the Lord gave me about 7 winds that are going to blow through this house. I told y'all the water is troubled. The water is troubled. And so I saw that, and I didn't see all of the details, but I saw that the sermon series was about from relapse to recovery. And before I kind of tell you what I'm going to talk about, let me give you a quick definition about relapse. Relapse is to fall or slip back into a former state. I need you to catch that. Relapse means to fall or slip back into a former state. So right off the top, we see a real clear reality. The issue is on the inside already. Listen to what I'm saying. We think relapse is when people go out there and get into something. Relapse means you fall back into something that was already there. Uh-oh, this is going to be a little weighted today. Can I prove it? Romans 3 and 23 says in the King James, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory." That's for that religious spirit. Romans 7 and 18 says in the ESV, "For I know that nothing good dwells in me." Look at your neighbor and say, "Nothing. That's in my flesh. For I have a desire to do what's right, but not the ability to carry it out." Oh, we like to condemn and the people, but the word of the Lord says, "For I know that nothing good dwells in me in my flesh, for I have the desire to do right, but not the ability to carry it out." Uh-oh. One more scripture with that. Romans 7 and 21 says in the King James, "I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is always present." Can I be myself today? Well, I don't know how to be nobody else anyway, so it's what I got. Now, I know that a lot of us are quick to jump on scriptures. We love scriptures like Galatians 5 and 19 through 21 that talks about, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, and these things, adultery and fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murderers, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I told you in the past, they that do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." Now we're aware of those things. We know, all right, listen, you can't do this. You shouldn't be doing this. This is wrong. But now what about in Proverbs 6, and I'm going to go take this from the NIV, and 16 says, "These six things the Lord does hate. Seven are detestable to him. Haughty eyes." Oh, ain't nobody said nothing. Side-eyeing the people. Head this high, your eyes looking down low. Oh, can I get a witness in this house? A lying tongue. Can't trust none coming out your mouth. You believe the stuff you're saying. You've been saying it so long. Hands that shed innocent blood. Oh, we think that's just in the natural. But whose reputation has your mouth killed? A heart that devises wicked schemes. Plotting and planning on folks. Getting in little groups because you want to expose somebody. Well, I don't hear nobody talking about that. Feet that are quick to rush into evil. You always seem to know everything going on with everybody. Some go down, you the first one calling everybody. Who assigned you? Are they paying you to let us know who died, who cheated, who fell? Oh, some of y'all can't even get free because they sitting right next to you, but you better bless them anyhow. A false witness who pours out lies, making assumptions, and you ain't even got the reality. Talking about stuff you know not of. And the one that just stirs me up on the inside, a person who stirs up conflict in the community. Mess starters. Oh, come on, because see, some of y'all been bit by these serpents, but I'm coming to expose the enemy today. We're going to be free in this house. And so all things dwell on the inside. Look at your neighbor and say, oh, it's in you. Here's the thing. And I'm getting to my thought, but here's the thing. I love Romans 5:8 in the NIV says this, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, woo, isn't that good news? Christ died for us. Matter of fact, 1 Peter 4:8 lets us know that love covers a multitude of sin. And then Ephesians 1:7 says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Why then do we fall back? Why do we relapse? I'll give you the answer. Because we're uncovered. Ask your neighbor a question. Are you covered? Uh-oh. I was doing some research and I was looking at how do we form addictions? How do we get ourselves in this place? Because I just told you, I proved in the word that a lot of this stuff is in us. Then Christ redeems us, but then we go back to it. Well, researchers did experiments with mice, and what they were doing was they set up these cages, and in the cages they had food, they had water, and then they had drugs. And they wanted to see what the mice would preference. And at first the mice went right to the food and the water, and then they found out that the drugs made them feel some kind of way. True story. And so after a while, what happened was the mice got so addicted to the feeling that they forgot about the food. Woo, did y'all catch that already? I said the mice got so addicted to the feeling that they forgot about the food. They left the water. Now you need water to live. We need living water to live. But when you get addicted to the feeling, you'll forget about the food. You'll forget about the water. And so what happened was the researchers, the people that were doing the experiment said, well, what if we move the drugs and just leave the food and the water? For a while, oh, mice threw a fit. They didn't even want it. They kept looking for the feeling. When they almost passed out, I'm preaching better than y'all saying amen. When they got to the place where they were going to perish, then they decided to go on. Let me see what this food is about. Man, it's going to be deep in here. And that was the way. And here's the interesting part about it. The researcher said that, but what the mice kept doing was going back to the place where they got the drugs. Every now and again, they went to check to see if it was there. Because just in case it showed up, they were going to forget the food again. Woo! Am I breaking this thing down already? And so I said, well, God, I need to, you know, as my role, I am a coach, I'm a strategist, and this is what I help people do on a daily basis. Help me understand psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, why do we keep getting triggered? Well, the first thing that happens, what triggers us is something you might have heard of called HALT, H-A-L-T, HALT. The H is for hungry. Oh, y'all didn't hear me, and this ain't about food. When you get hungry, you're hungry because you're not eating what you need to fill you up. Y'all seen that Snickers commercial? They say, when you get hungry, you're not you. And they put somebody else in place, a little angry, bitter person. Then they eat a Snicker, and all of a sudden they come back to themselves. Can I tell you that's what you look like in the spirit? How often are you eating the word? Talking about HALT, H-A-L-T. The A is for angry. when you are angry, unforgiveness, it happened 20 years ago, you still ready to fight. Unforgiveness, he done moved on and married somebody else and you still waiting for an I'm sorry. Unforgiveness, can't let it go. It's an anchor that keeps you in place. Unforgiveness, because that's not what you saw your life looking like. And so I'm not moving on until my life comes in alignment with what I planned for me. And Jesus is basically saying, you don't tell me what to do. Angry. The L is for lonely. Oh, I don't hear nobody in here. You can be surrounded by people and still alone. Lonely because nobody understands who you really are. Lonely because nobody can identify with the sorrows of your soul. Oh, we breaking loose triggers. And then the T is for tired. You just tired. Overwhelmed. Trying to be everybody's hero. Every time an issue come, you run into the closet and slap on your cape and come out to save the day. Dun, 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 dun. Ain't got enough money to take care of your own bills, but here you go. You got hell in your own marriage, but here you go. Your children acting a fool, but here you go. And you think the S on your chest stands for Superman and Superwoman, but it stands for stop it, sir. The S on your chest stands for sit down, sis. You trying to be the savior when you need to lead them to the savior. Pastor said, I can't drop this mic, but I'm telling you, that was a mic drop. And so we're triggered by the halt. Woo, this is good. We're triggered because we have no emotional discipline. Somebody can halfway say one thing to you and you ready to jump, fight, act a fool, defensive. Emotional discipline. You crying about everything. Can't nobody even tell you, well, baby, your wig just slided a little to the left and you about to cry. Y'all talking about me. No, we don't want you to embarrass yourself. It ain't that serious. You got to be offended by everything? Well, they don't like me. Child, they ain't like Jesus. No emotional discipline. And you wonder why people won't put you in certain positions, because I can't trust your emotional stability. Oh, this might not be for this house, but I'm helping somebody. Triggers, stress. I have a mantra that I teach my mentors in my mentorship program. And I have them to say something very simple. I can't be everything to everybody all the time. Somebody need to practice that. Say this after me. I can't be everything to everybody all the time. Didn't you feel a little freedom come through there right then? Here's one. Overconfidence. Oh, you just think you are the thing, baby. This what it sound like. Well, can I? I got it. Well, I was just trying to. Oh, I already know how to do that. Well, I was just trying to, I'm good. Ooh, shoulders got tight in here. We know the word of the Lord says pride comes before. Ask your neighbor, can I help you? Ooh. Here it is. Mental or physical illness is a trigger. We love dealing with things from one perspective, but we really don't understand it from another perspective. Mental health has a really bad connotation to it. People don't want to see therapists. They don't want to get a coach. They don't want to get deep into what's going on. But, you know, I'm one of those righteous rebels, and I just believe that so many times ministries want holiness, but they don't want to give wholeness. I just want you to live right, but I'm broken. I just want you to act right, but I'm broken. More times in the Bible, you'll hear God and Jesus asking the question, "Will thou be made whole?" They would come to him for healing, but he wanted to know, "Will you be made whole?" All right. Another trigger, social isolation. You don't want to fool with nobody. Ooh, I don't do teams. I prefer to work alone. I can't be on that committee. I don't like that. I run this thing solo. That ain't even biblical. The Bible says no man is an island. If you fall, who gonna help you up? No, I want to know, all y'all solo people, get out there and fall and lick and crack. Who gonna help you? Isolation is a trigger. I'm helping. Dysfunctional relationships. Am I coming down the aisle? Dysfunctional relationships. You know that girl crazy. You know that man unstable. How do you know? Because he double-minded, and a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Woo! Triggers. Here's one people don't think about that is a trigger. Getting a promotion, advancing will trigger you to go backwards. Uh-oh. Some of us want the gift, but not the responsibility. I need a promotion on my job. And then they say, "Well, you know what? We're going to give you a promotion." Wait a minute. That means I got to show up on time. That means I got to not only do my work, but be responsible for somebody else. Uh-oh. And that thing will trigger you because your gifts make room. But we talked about yesterday, but what does the packaging look like? Another trigger is reminiscing or glamorizing your past. Well, you know, I almost was a football pro. Yeah, that was 20 years ago, bruh. Well, y'all know I was almost, I see y'all like that, but you know, I almost, that was my position, but ma'am, but that's not the case now. And so you can't embrace who you're becoming because you're so busy trying to remember who you've been. Tell your neighbor, it's a trigger. Last but not least, environment availability. Can I help you? There are some people called assignment assassins. And I've said this before, but it bears saying it again. You need to understand who is an assistant and who is an assassin. Some people are coming because they want to help you help yourself. But some people are coming because they want to get from you so you can't have it for yourself. And so we have to be mindful about who's in our environment because it's a trigger. I said at the conference that I was here a few months ago that you have to ask yourself a question. Are they a midwife or are they a murderer? Why is this a trigger? Because you're carrying something. And midwives are designed to notice. Wait a minute, she's changing. something different about him today. You know, when you're pregnant, your countenance changes. Your shape changes. Your appetite changes. There are certain environments you can no longer be in. You gotta watch what you eat. You must be careful about what you drink. And there are people that's watching you, and they've noticed that you've changed. And so all of a sudden, think about it, when a woman is pregnant, people start getting real nosy. They start saying things like, ooh, where you do? Tell your neighbor it's a trap. They trying to find out, when you supposed to be opening that new business? When that book supposed to be dropping? I heard you was getting ready to have a program. When is that? You better dust off your discernment and find out if that's a midwife or a murderer. People real nosy when they find out you carrying something. They start asking you questions. They start saying, is it a boy or a girl? Why? Because they're trying to discern your destiny. Something's stirring on the inside of you, and people need to know, are you a prophet? Are you a preacher? Are you a pastor? I need to know, who are you? Some of it's just because they're trying to gain access. And so you must be mindful, because there are certain things that will trigger you. And if you're not prepared, if you're not postured, if you're not in position, you will relapse. What am I saying? We are susceptible to relapse because we too revealed. You're showing too much. Uh-oh. Too much people are able to see. You know how it is when you go somewhere and people are wearing revealing clothes? That's because it's some things that need to be covered. There are some things that are not meant for everybody to see. And so, the reason why we relapse is because we too revealed. What are you revealing? I have this Mic Drop Monday every Monday night on Facebook Live, and I was talking one time about what's that smell. And I was saying that whatever is on the inside of you will emit in the outside. Sometimes you ever wonder, those of you all that are single or married, you ever wonder when things get a little rocky, all of a sudden look like everybody and their grandma coming for you? Are we gonna tell the truth in here? They caught me. How did they know to get up on me right when I was vulnerable? It may be because you're revealing too much. How is it that this person always knows how to push my buttons? Perhaps because you're revealing too much. Can I drop a mic? They won't know what you don't show. I need to say this over here. They won't know what you don't show. You showing them how sensitive you are. You showing them how sexual you are. You showing them how needy you are. You're showing them that they can manipulate you. And so you relapse because you too revealed. Tell your neighbor it's time to cover up. Woo! All right. I was thinking that the best place to figure out what needs to be covered and why it needs to be covered is simply found in the word of the Lord. And the Lord does this to me all the time. He takes me to something familiar in the word, and then he gives me a completely different perspective of it. So he took me to a scripture I've been looking at my whole life, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 through 18. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 through 18. And I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to break it down and show you why we uncovered. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 11 says, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Here's when it gets good, and here's where we're going to get some apostolic instruction today. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So God is giving us the remedy for relapse. Woo! If I had to take a subtopic, I've always wanted to say that, I would use the remedy for relapse. The remedy for relapse is to recover. Y'all see what I did there? We talking about recover, but he said the remedy is to recover. Lift your hands and say, cover me again. Woo! Oh, y'all should have gave him praise right there. The remedy for relapse. It ain't recovery. It's recover. The first thing in this scripture that he tells us to do is to cover our loins. If I can break this down, your loins represents your desire. Uh-oh. See, that went over somebody's head. I need y'all to hear this. James 1 and 14 says in the CEV that we are tempted by our own desires. And I like the way it said it, that drag us off and trap us. Sound like a relapse to me. And so, when our desires are not covered, we risk relapse. Tell your neighbor, cover your desires. Be careful what you tell people about what you want. Because the enemy will take it, capture it, pervert it, and present it a different way. And you will be thinking, that's what the Lord God sent to me, but it's disguised as a distraction. And so be mindful about how you expose your desires. The Bible says that if we delight ourselves in him, he'll give us the desires. So why are you exposing them? You're too revealed. The second thing he tells us to cover, he says, put on the breastplate of righteousness. And so what he's telling us to cover our hearts with integrity. We don't like that word, integrity. Jeremiah 17 and 9 says that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The reason why we have to protect our heart is because it is what pumps blood. It is what gives life to everything else. That's why so many of us sitting here today have wounds. And we're wounded because we forgot to cover our hearts. We just jump right in and we just let them tell us what we wanted to hear. And we forgot to cover our hearts. Sometimes we be so busy covering our heads that we leave our hearts exposed. We so busy making sure things make sense, making sure it looks right, but our heart is exposed. And we need the breastplate of righteousness because if somebody shoots at us, they're not going to miss. And so ask your neighbor, is your heart covered? So many of us have been victims of manipulation, victims of people exploiting our desires, victims because people got close to us, making us think they needed us, but they just needed what was in our hand and not what was in our heart. Our hearts were exposed. We didn't know how to say no. Our hearts were exposed. We keep taking them back, and we know they doing us low down and dirty because our hearts are exposed. Is this helping? The third thing he talks about our feet. He says, cover your feet with readiness to spread good news. Are you in alignment with your assignment? Are you postured for your purpose? I said one time, I have a new coaching program called Assignment Alignment, and I put a post up one day on LinkedIn, and I said, you can have a profession and still not be operating in your purpose. I go to work every day. I clock in, I clock out. I come home. I take care of my kids. I eat. I fall asleep. I start back over the next day. There is motion, but no movement. And if we were to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, we stuck. And you know what happens when a car gets stuck? A couple of things happen if you stay stuck. One of the things you'll do, you keep spinning your wheel, trying to get out of there. And dirt is covering your vehicle. Some of us look like we're stuck because it's too much dirt covering our vehicle. When you stay stuck, you get covered in mess. You can't stay in a place too long. You can't stay in despair too long. You can't stay in disappointment too long. You'll get covered in mess. If you stay stuck with your car too long, you risk locking the engine. And now when love try to find you, you can't be open. Ooh, that was for somebody over here in this area. And now when joy tries to find you, you can't receive it. Because you stay stuck too long. If you stay stuck too long, your car gonna run out of gas. So that when you finally get unstuck, you can't go nowhere. Some of y'all spending all your time, your money, and your efforts facilitating relationships that stuck. They ain't going nowhere. And when you finally get free, you recognize, I ain't got no gas. That's why we need him to Some of us just need a fill up. And so protect your assignment. The fourth thing that he talks about in this, he talks about taking the shield of faith. We are supposed to cover our bodies with faith. Faith protects us from fear. I need y'all to hear that. Faith protects us from fear. I teach this all of the time in my mentorship, and I say that the emotion of fear is an assistant. The emotion of fear assists you. It tells you, hey, that looks like that's hot. Hey, that looked dangerous over there. But the spirit of fear is an assassin. It's coming to take you out. It's coming to take out your mind. It's coming to take your money. It's coming to take your marriage. It's coming to take your ministry. And so you got to protect yourself with faith. And last but not least, and let me stop there. Let me deal with this faith for just a minute. Some of y'all faith needs some Febreze. First lady told me to say it again. Some of you need to Febreze your faith. What happens is, faith is simply trust. And if we were to tell the truth, the reason why we stuck, the reason why we relapsing is because we really don't trust God like we say we do. Our faith needs for breathing. I'll tell you why. If you think about it, when you let a whole lot of people in your house for a long time. Ooh, that was a revelation. I said, when you let a lot of people in your house for a long time, after they leave, you notice something funny in your atmosphere. Look at my face. Something don't smell quite right. I love all the clean people. Yes, I know that's the truth. You'll notice that there are different types of Febreze. There's one for fabric. Oh, that's a revelation, because some scents go deep. There's a Febreze for air, because some things are toxic in your atmosphere. And what I love about Febreze is Febreze doesn't do what other things do, because other things mask the odor. See, when you're in relapse and you don't get recovered, what you'll do is mask the odor. And after a few days, the real scent reemerges. Some of us are masking the odors of loneliness. We're masking the odors of fear. We're masking odors. And after a minute, the real scent reemerges. And so what Febreze does, it traps odors. And then it makes them disappear. So what happens to us is, when we thought life was going to go a certain kind of way, when we thought people were going to treat us right, when we thought our finances wasn't going to act a fool, our faith was big. But then doubt came in, and fear came in, exploitation came in, and our faith started to get filthy. God, at first I believed that I could jump this off and you were going to catch me. Now, where them stairs at? No. Oh, I just helped somebody. Why hadn't I jumped into that business? Because my faith ain't been Febrezed. Why haven't I wrote that book? My faith ain't been Febrezed. Why haven't I left that man? Faith ain't been Febrezed. Why still mess around with that? Why am I still dabbling in that? So my faith hasn't been Febrezed. Let me just say this, and I don't know why I'm going this way, but be careful what you dabble in. Because there are some things that open portals that you know not of. And when your faith is filthy, you'll look for other tunnels to get what you want. You'll start chanting and lighting some stuff up and rubbing some stuff together and plucking out folks' hair and writing folk name in a book. And oh, I'm in the house. When you don't trust God, you trust something else. And if that's you, you sure need to Febreze your faith. Because the enemy cares nothing about you. His job is to expose you and leave you. I better say this again. He wants to expose you and then leave you. That's why it's important to have a pastor that can cover. That's why it's important to have a leader who can cover. When Noah was in a drunken state, he had two sons that represented the spirit and the flesh. One wanted to expose him and show everybody he ain't who y'all thought he was. Oh, y'all thought they were all that? Let me show you who they are. Let me expose them. And one son said, the devil is a liar. Cover him. You better find you somebody that can cover. Look at your neighbor and say, recover. And this is out here to somebody. Some of y'all ain't been under a covering for a long time. I'm here. I told y'all that apostolic don't play. I'm here to let you know you better find some cover, because a rain is coming. There is a storm coming. And you know what happens when storm comes? It takes stuff out. All of a sudden, your electricity goes out. your internet goes out. And when your electricity goes out, nothing in your house functions correctly. Oh, I better say that again. If your electricity goes out, ain't nothing in your house going to function correctly. And so tell your neighbor, take cover. You better find a house to run into. I need to say this. There is protection in the house. Woo! Some of y'all wondering, I've been just catching hell. My life been going crazy. Everything been coming at me because you're not covered. Why is this stuff, everything is going all around me because you have no covering. Woo! Listen to me. The most important thing, and it leads me right to this point. The last thing that he tells us to cover is our head. Cover your head. Too many people speaking to you. And you're spiritually and socially schizophrenic. Cover your head. Too many people plant ideas in your mind and you wonder why you're double-minded. Cover your head. You're running after everybody that looks good and that glitters and that sound like they got a word but no sound doctrine. Cover your head. Sending money to people you don't know, trying to get a vial of oil and some leaves to sprinkle over a house. You better cover your head. Seeking out people that'll tell you what you want to hear and not what you need to hear. Cover your head. You got people that's validating you in your wrongdoing and won't get you free. Cover your head. You with a group of people that's jealous of who you really are, and so they trying to intimidate you and make you feel bad about what you look like. Cover your head. You can't even tell people that you got a blessing of the Lord because you ashamed that they gonna look at you funny. Cover your head. I done messed around and got mad. You better cover your head. Oh, I feel Jesus. Your head is uncovered. And because your head is uncovered, your thoughts are open. You wonder why you suicidal because you uncovered. You wonder why you can't break depression off your life. Your head is uncovered. You wonder why the spirit of murder is in your heart. Your head is uncovered. You wonder why your finances won't come in order. Your head. Oh, this ain't for everybody, but you tell somebody you better cover your head. Be mindful of what you let in your head. The Bible says that you can literally be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let me drop a revelation that works both ways. Y'all missed it. That works both ways. The Bible gives us principles. It works both ways. He's telling you, be easy about who you let in your ear, because your whole life gonna look different if you change your mind about something. I don't know why I don't like them no more. They were cool with me, but I don't know. It's funny. Well, who was that in your head? Now all of a sudden you got transformed. Why are you acting so fun? Because somebody got in your head. We used to talk, we used to fellowship. What? You used to come, what? Somebody got in your head. So you may want to ask yourself, who's in my head? Ooh, y'all ain't gonna like me in this, huh? And so what I love, I'm almost done. So what I love about Jesus is that he does not leave us uncovered. And listen, that was a good place. Amen. That was a good place. People have left us uncovered. And we relapsed because they found out our secrets. They figured out what we were vulnerable about, and they uncovered us. And they left us. Oh, is any witnesses in the house? Can we just tell the truth? And have you ever been left uncovered? Let me throw my... And so why is the Bible the good news? The scripture, I got so happy, I almost ran. Romans 8 and 35 says, nay, in all these things, we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. But that ain't even what I got excited about. I got excited because he's showing me how he covers me. He says, I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. Somebody should be getting happy. Nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate me from the love of Christ. Give your neighbor a high five and say, he got me covered. David said it like this, and I got too excited. David said in Psalm 139, if I ascend into the heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. If I take on the wings of the morning, you. And so, I am on assignment to declare that your redemption is in your recover. Woo, y'all didn't hear it. Your redemption is in your recovery. If you were to take a moment and be honest with yourself, you know that there are some things that you've allowed to get uncovered. Can we just take a moment? Take a moment and think about us. I guarantee you, if you think about the areas in your life that's acting crazy, whether it be your finances, your family, your faith, fear, fatigue, I can guarantee you there's a place that's uncovered. Bad relationships, your heart's uncovered. Bad money choices, your mind's uncovered. What's uncovered? Maybe it was your heart. Maybe it was your head. Maybe your assignment got uncovered. You were protecting your assignment, and then you just, I know God called me to do that, but people done messed over me. I failed too many times. I got tired. I don't feel qualified. And so now my assignment is uncovered. You experienced a relapse. And so now you're open, you're vulnerable. The enemy wants to keep you from progressing in your purpose. Hear me. But we bind the hand of the enemy. And we declare that every assignment of hell against you is broken. Can you say that corporately? I declare that every assignment of hell against me is broken. Oh, I felt the winds. Somebody stand and make that declaration again. Woo! I need to hear you make that declaration. I declare that every assignment of hell against me is broken. I declare that every assignment of hell against me broken. Get an attitude with it. I declare that every assignment of hell against me is broken. If you believe it, bless him. On last Sunday, I feel the anointing. The prophetic is about to rush through here. On last Sunday, I was in church. And I was sitting in the back of the church. I've never been here a day in my life before yesterday. And the Lord talked to me about this church. And then he had talked to me about today. So no matter whose church you go to, he talked to me about Sunday. Pastor Campbell, he said that the wind of God was going to rush through this sanctuary. He didn't stop there. He named the wind. As I call out the names of the wind, if you need a rush of that wind, I don't care what folks looking like next to you, they better get in this windfall for themselves. But if you need the wind of God, when I call out that wind, this is what we're going to do corporately. And then if the Lord gives me some prophetic words, I'm going to give them to you. But I'm going to call out a wind, and I want the church to say, blow, wind, blow. Is it just me, or do y'all feel the weight of glory? There's a few people here over here that's never experienced what you experience. And you, somebody here, there's a cool breeze going down your right arm. You're saying, what? Is that you? Who is that? I felt it. There's a cool breeze. God is healing you. He's healing you physically. You will not suffer. Another day. Raise your hand, woman of God, and receive. Winds of healing find you now. Church, say, blow, wind, blow. I send the wind of healing to cover you now. I've never done this before. The first wind that is about to blow is the wind of recovery. This wind is for those. Listen. This wind is for those who emotionally need a hospital. You walk in with a limp emotionally. Something hits you so hard that you walk in like this in the spirit. You walk, I feel the wind. You walk in like this in the spirit. You saying, I can't even stand up straight. You can't see because your sight need recovering. Ooh, you can't hear. Woo! Because your sound needs recovering. You even scared to speak because your voice needs recovering. Woo! Matter of fact, you can, if it's you, come run up here. I'm just gonna wave over you, and we're gonna command the winds of recovery to blow. Oh yeah, y'all better come. I ain't staying long. All I'm gonna do is wave over you. If you need recovery, and I yon double check on the by and the bay, she nay on double on the by. Lift your hands, intercessors. I need you praying, Hundable. Church, every time you hear me say winds of recovery, I need to hear blow, winds blow. Make your way to the altar. And if I say another one and you need to come again, you better come get your second win. Oh, ain't no shame up in here today. God is looking for a people that is ready, tendable. And so winds of recovery. Blow, wind, blow. I need to hear y'all, church. Winds of recovery. Blow, underbay. Blow, wind, blow. Underbay, your name. Thank you. But listen, the next wind. You may take your seat, but the next wind. Y'all two come here. The Lord just spoke to me. God says, y'all had to spend a lot of stuff. There was something that happened. And y'all had to put out a lot. Y'all had to invest a lot. To the point where it seemed like you weren't going to recover. You trusted God and you didn't even have it. You kept giving. I don't know y'all. You kept giving when you didn't have it. You kept giving when people didn't treat you right. God says the winds of wealth were about to blow.
Hear me.
Not lose again. And he said, for your faithfulness, double. Woo! In Jesus' name, the next wind. The next wind. And this, it's been on me. I was talking to Khalila last night and she said it, and I said, let me go show you this, my notebook. God told me this wind was blowing. Get real soft. I need y'all to hear this. And I want you to listen. The winds of reconciliation are going to blow. There are some people here that need to reconcile.
Welcome to the...
The reason that the winds of destruction have been hit, the storms of destruction have been hitting you, is because you're out of alignment. There are some people, honestly, that need to reconcile with Pastor Campbell. He ain't even in a judgmental place. He gonna receive you with open arms. Let me tell you something. The winds of reconciliation are blowing. There are some mothers who need to reconcile with their children. There are some former friends who need to reconcile with one another. There's somebody you've been out of pocket with a minute. While the anointing of God is here, listen. We ain't gonna have no conversation about what happened, who was wrong, who was right, what happened. The winds of reconciliation. If that's you, I need you to get up here right now. You need to be reconciled. I wouldn't be ashamed if I was you. Some of y'all are in marriages that need the wind of reconciliation to blow. I would grab my partner and run. The winds of reconciliation are in the house. Woo, I feel it. Listen. If, and I know it's cliche, but if there's somebody you need to reconcile with, if I were you, I would just go find them and hug them. And I promise you that the power of God is going to break every stronghold, every misunderstanding. And now this gonna really snatch you. There are some of you all in this house that you were the person that was offended. But because the winds of reconciliation are here, you can go to the person that offended you, and the winds of reconciliation will blow. Some of the reason they haven't reconciled is because they don't know how. They honestly don't even know what to say. Y'all better hear me. They don't even know how to articulate. I'm sorry. But if you'll embrace them, if you'll grab them, tell y'all the winds. Somebody shout, the winds are blowing. There's somebody here, there's a husband. You said something to your wife real ugly. You ain't even got to show yourself. And you weren't doing it because you hate her or you angry. You doing it out of your own pain. You need to reconcile. Just a, I'm sorry, you damaged something in her that was already damaged. She just need a, I'm sorry. There's some husbands in here that are hurt. Wife, you got a real quick tongue. And because he's so sensitive to you, break the music just a little bit. Because he's so sensitive to you, you don't realize that your words wounded him. I don't care what position you in. You better find that man. Reconcile. Because you hit something in him that was already wounded. You said something that sounded like his mama said it. I gotta stop for a second. Every wounded man, come here really quick. Bring my oil. Bring the gold one. Every wounded man, come here. This ain't the time. We ain't caring about. Y'all make room. Make room for the men. I'm sorry, I gotta deal with this. Oh, the women ought to be rejoicing. Listen, this is healing. Men don't move quick. It's like the third time I've done this. There's an anointing, unusual anointing on me for men, wounded men. And I sense the brokenness. Y'all can't even allow yourself to show brokenness. Woo! Listen, I'm going to do something I do this. I've only done this twice, but men, I need to apologize to y'all on behalf of the women. We are sorry. Some of these words y'all ain't heard. Some of these women can't even, they can't hear past their own brokenness. So God sent me here on assignment to stand on their behalf and say, I'm sorry for taking you for granted. I'm sorry for thinking you were just a glorified ATM. I'm sorry for not understanding how tired you were. I'm sorry for putting so much pressure on you without thinking about how much you could even carry. I'm sorry for not recognizing that you didn't even have anybody to go to. I'm sorry for not remembering that your own father wasn't a good example and that you're doing the best you can with what you know. Hey. sorry for words that wounded. I'm sorry for making assumptions without even asking. I'm sorry for forgetting that you need love too. I'm sorry for neglecting your needs. I'm sorry for thinking I was the only important person in your life. I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? And so winds of reconciliation blow. Woo! Winds of healing blow. Winds of healing blow. Winds of reconciliation. I want y'all to do me a favor, because every man at this altar has a wound. Can you grab him and just say, I got you? You don't even know. Some man ain't never even heard. Come on, I got you. Find you somebody to. Woo! Women, y'all ought to be rejoicing and praying. All right. Okay. I had to do that. So everybody else that came for reconciliation, y'all can come on back now. Let's get this thing back on track. Woo! God is doing unusual things in this aisle. Winds of reconciliation. Woo, years of misunderstanding. Years of damage because she didn't know any better. She didn't have any better. She didn't have an example. She did the best she could with what she had. Ooh, she was abandoned herself. And so she didn't know how to teach you. And so we release anger. Woo, and unforgiveness. I release you from depression now. I release you now. Woo! There's a lot of things that y'all haven't shared with each other about what you've been through. Not because you was trying to hide it, but the wounds were so deep. You pressed through the best you knew how. And you did the best you could with what you had. But nobody gave you a blueprint. You had to figure it out along the way. And so I bind every negative word that was spoken against you that wounded your heart. Every word that tried to pierce your self-esteem, that came from the people you love, oh God, that you've been carrying so long, trying to live up to it. It's breaking now. Be free. Be free. Be free. And so wind blow. 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 You know, you see the glory, but you don't even know the story. Sometimes we take people's kindness for weakness, and we don't even understand what it takes for them just to stand. The wounds of the past, the words that hurt, the words that were spoken that kept you stagnant and not moving forward. We bind up every negative word in the Bible. We arrest your bloodline and we come for your destiny. Destiny be birthed. Healing for your wounds. Winds of reconciliation blow. God is healing in this house. Y'all come. Reconciliation. Sometimes what we've been through makes us act a certain way. Rather than tell our story, rather than relive the hurts of our past, sometimes we keep our heart guarded. And anytime something even sounds like it's gonna take us back, we fight. Oh, because we in survival mode. And so, God, now I pray for healing. Of reconciliation blow. He's crowning you with wisdom to understand another dimension of discernment, because you asked him for it. I hear you asking, God, if I could just know, I wish I could see better. And God says that I am giving you that desire. And so now the winds of knowledge. Winds of reconciliation. In Jesus' name. Y'all feel the power of God in this place? You ain't always had it easy. A lot of times they didn't understand what you had to carry by yourself. You had to do it alone. You thought they would stay and they did not. And so you did the best you could with what you had. But you were often made to feel bad about it. You were often made to feel like you should have done what you couldn't even do. And so I ask on their behalf, forgive them and release them. God says, because you did the best you could, that now your ladder shall be greater. And so winds of restoration, everything that the cankerworm devoured, all the money you had to put up for them. Oh, when you had to put your finances on the line for them. God says the wind of recovery. You shall recover all. You shall. Oh, y'all ought to be giving him praise for mother. You shall recover all. And so winds of reconciliation blow. Y'all come. Y'all dealing with similar issues. Similar issues, because I see similar spirits. Brokenness made to feel a certain kind of way. Criticized. Everything you did, critiqued. Made to feel like you were nobody. Is that y'all? Yeah, that's because that's the spirit hovering over. But winds of righteousness are blowing. Tende, baby. Shinaya. And every unclean thing that tried to attach itself to you. You did things because you didn't think you were worthy of nothing else. But winds of righteousness blow. Oh, blow, wind, blow. I don't hear y'all out there. The winds are blowing. Where's the reconciliation needed here? Yo, you, come on, you. Hey, raise your hand. Thank you. Y'all feeling the last wind? Y'all together? Yeah, come here. Yeah, I can't even move on. I said this out loud because here's the cycle that we're interrupting today. It's gonna set somebody free today. There's a generation of mothers who came up real hard. Ugly stuff was said about you and to you. There was some abuse you couldn't even speak about. Because what's done in the house stays in the house. And for years, you live with the pain and the embarrassment and the shame, and nobody came to restore you. You had to heal on the go, and you ain't healed yet. And so winds of healing I'm talking about over 23 years of woo. Couldn't even defend yourself. Winds of healing. You couldn't even talk to nobody about it. Winds of healing. Trying to be the best in spite of. But it's almost like there's this record that keeps playing in your mind about what was said. And you try to do everything, and I hear you like, oh, I'm good. I don't even care about that anymore, but it's still here. When all you really wanted was, I'm sorry. And you wanted it from somebody who couldn't even say the words. Oh, God. And so today, I'm sorry. I'm trying to move on. But this house needed healing. Woo! Sometimes people tear through and they don't even look back at the damage they left. And everybody else gotta just strengthen what remains. But today the doctor is in the house. There's one last wind that's about to sweep through this place, and I don't know if it's a metaphor or if it's actually going to happen here, but it is the wind of revival. The wind of rumble, I want to rumble. The wind of revival is about said you were giving up. But come alive. Woo! Winds of revival. Oh, you were always good enough. You were always. Cancel every negative word to tear you down, to make you feel worthless, to make you think you were nobody. And I command the warrior to arise, warrior. Tell you what I feel. There's like a cyclone about to take place in this house. Oh, listen, Tish, lay your hands, blow. Noble, winds, blow. Winds, blow. Winds, blow. Winds, blow. Winds, blow. Winds, blow. Watch this, watch this. I need every pastor, every preacher, evangelist, whatever your title, but if you are a ministry leader, because revival starts with you. And some of y'all need a revival. Because the truth is, you've given out so much and nobody poured back into you. Oh, I need y'all to get here quick while the winds are blowing. If somebody is under your leadership in ministry, oh, you better get this wind of revival that is about to blow. If I were you, I would. Listen, musician, thank you, sir. I was going to say, if you need to make your way here, the winds of and if I were y'all and under anybody's leadership, I'd be praying, winds of revival blow. But the winds are blowing. Out there in the audience, y'all feel the winds blowing? Sweet. Say that again, the winds are blowing. One more time, blow, wind, blow. And so winds of revival. The winds of revival are coming. To resurrect. When you're in ministry serving so long, I would know. I've been serving in ministry over 24 years. When you serve in ministry for so long, you get weak. You get wounded. And because people always need you, you have to work wounded. And what I need y'all that's watching to understand is these are wounded workers who are in need of revival. And so everybody at the altar, raise your hand and say, revive us again. Woo! The winds are blowing. Revive us again. Oh, Nabaya Nebe, revive us again. I know. Shenebe, Lord, Abaya Nebaya. Tendabai, revive us again. Y'all come, revive us again. There's a need that you don't even talk about. You serve in the middle of the need. Not certain how it's going to be handled. Sometimes saying, God, you know, you ain't working quick enough. We might need to find something else to do. I heard you say it. Sorry, he speaks to me like that. Did you say that? Holy Ghost, a tattletale. I thought y'all knew that. And I heard you in your heart say, all right, we might plan B. But you never wavered. Even when it was too much. Even when you wanted to say no. Even when you were advised against it. And you did anyway. I heard the Lord says, you not only have my heart, but you have my ear. Ask what you will. Woo! And I heard the Lord say, winds of wealth. Amen. The winds of wealth are blowing on everything you put your hands to do. I don't know what your business is, but God says that the winds of wealth are about to blow on your business. Woo! Winds of wealth are blowing. You're going to be looking crazy. People are going to be giving and seeking you out for your wisdom. And so favor follows you. Wealth thunderable follows you. You need favor for the wealth and wealth for the favor. God is about to do a transformation and y'all gonna see it. And he's gonna prove that he rewards the faithful. God says you don't have to prostitute nothing. You don't have to sell yourself short. I reward. Lord, send a revival. We need revival, 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 revival. Lord, send revival, revival. And so, to every empty cup, shinibibi. God says, I'm not filling your cup, but this is your season for overflow. And so winds of overflow. Oh, I don't hear y'all. Blow, wind, blow. Woo, you've been pouring from an empty cup, but God says, overflow. Hey! Nobody had ever shown day you'll die. And so lift your hands. Everybody in the audience pointing this way. God send revival. Send revival. Send revival. Send refreshing. Send revival. Send a refreshing. You who are weary, revive strength now. Revive the strength. You who are weak, noble, revival. Sir, you. God says, I have found you faithful. He says, I have found you to be faithfulness. And he simply said to me, tell my son, well done. Receive the refreshing. Hands up, receive God's refreshing. Receive the winds of refreshing. So last two people I need to pray for, this lady right here in the green, you. And you on the end. You. You knew I was coming. Come on. Confusion in your atmosphere. Right? Okay. Told y'all the Holy Ghost will tattletale. God just trust me to tell. There's a lot of confusion in your atmosphere. God says, here's your apostolic instructions. Number one, he says, cut the cord. Cut it. Not move, cut it. He says, because what he has for you is not for them. And that the only reason why your progress has been delayed is because it's just for you. He says that the things that you went through didn't invalidate you for it. It's what qualified you for it. And so the winds of acceptance, and he said, you are accepted in the beloved. And so winds of acceptance, and maybe. Blow wind, blow. God says, I receive you, daughter. You were always enough. And that you will always be. And so winds of acceptance blow. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God says, you're doing everything but what I called you to do. And that you masquerading behind giftings, but ain't operating in the gift. Because you sensitive about him. You so sensitive to God where you say, God, before I mess up, I won't even do it. If I'm gonna make you shame, I ain't even putting my hands on it. And that's what he told me to tell you. You are worth it. You are the perfect package. Hey! Woo! Woo! You are the perfect package. it. And so winds of assignment, oh yandebe, and winds of purpose blow and die. No more masquerading and no more hiding, but blow. And God says, give me your yes and that. Oh, that's what he needs today. Come on, lift your I'm done. Can we give God now a celebratory praise? Oh, come on, I'm going to celebrate. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done in this house. Oh, come on, celebrate him. Hey, God. Woo. Hallelujah.
Please remain standing. If you're not standing, would you please stand? Hallelujah. Sometimes when it's all been said and you agree, you just say, amen. 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 Hallelujah. What a word, what a word. And it's been so good. I was thinking on Friday night, and I'll let you go, give me 3 minutes and I'm gonna release you. On Friday night, no, actually on Saturday, when she was sharing, I thought, Lord, she's sharing right on the money of what God was saying and what God is doing. God showed me, and I shared with our leadership, that he was doing a revival, that I knew that this year was the year of increase. God has proven himself to us. I shared with you that he was faithful, that even when we decreased in numbers of members, God increased the provision for the vision. Come on, y'all. That this year, this past year, that God exceeded our budget more than he ever has in our history, but yet the numbers had dwindled, probably the lowest they'd ever been in our history. God is not moved by numbers of people. He's moved by faith. He says, without that, you can't even please me. I'm excited. I'm excited that I shared on Friday night and Saturday that we were going to enter more dynamically into the prophetic. And I shared with the people that you can't give what you don't know. You can't lead where you can't go. And as God has just really pressed my heart to press in and move beyond all of the negative stereotypes and all of the games. I don't like games in church. And I seen them early on, and it tainted me toward the prophetic. And it seemed that I had more trouble out of the people with the gift in that area as well. But forgetting those things that are behind me and pressing forward to those things that are before me. I'm excited about what God is going to do. I'm excited. I'm just going to say amen and let y'all go home. I'm going to say, but hold on to your word. Husbands, wives, there was a spirit of reconciliation. Don't let it stop at the altar. If you need to have that conversation, don't let the sun go down. I know you came here, but he still needs to hear it. She still needs to hear it. It's cool that she saw you and he saw you praying about it. But faith without works is dead. And the enemy will always try to make sure you're not in place to hear the word, because I'm looking around for some people and they're not in here. I don't know where they're at. But that's how he works. You out there changing the trash bag when you need to be in here getting your trash changed. Out of pocket, out of place, missing it. I know what that's like. For a long time, when the spirit would get stirred up in my early church, man, I'd tip out. I wasn't about all that shouting and speaking in tongues and blow, blow, blow. But that was then. That was when I was a child. I thought as a child. At first, in fact, I spoke as a child before I thought. God is doing a new thing. I'm excited about it. I'm glad that you are here to hear this deposit. I'm going to pray and let you be released. And I thank you all for not moving during the altar call. Give yourselves a round of applause. Some people couldn't take it because the service went longer than an hour, hour and a half. How in the world can you not sit while God is doing work and changing lives, but you can go to Disneyland, stay 2 hours in a line to take a 5-minute ride? But when you get to church, you say, don't take all that. Yes, it takes that. For some of us got free, somebody say, yeah, it takes that. It takes that. It takes that. It takes that. But thank you all for staying through. Those that left, they were like I was. They are not sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Lift up both your hands. I want to pray before we release you. Lord God, we thank you for what we have heard. We thank you that we need to recover. We need to be mindful of our own triggers. We need to know that, God, the storm didn't come to destroy us. It came to develop us. So, Father, let us lean into you. Let us acknowledge you in all of our ways. And we ask that you direct us. Help us to know who to close our ears to and who to open up our hearts to. Father, help us to leave every hurt, every misunderstanding, every divisive act done intentionally and unintentionally. Let us leave it here at the altar, and let us pick up your word and your power to give us a new future. Watch over us and keep us. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed. Come on, blessed. Everybody say bless. We're blessed in the city. Oh, yeah. We're blessed in the field. Oh, yeah.
brothers and sisters. I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be?